Hi, good evening. So basically, I'm going to talk about Ramayan and Mahabharat. That's what I do all the time. I find all the knowledge in the world in just these two epics. You know, I was just listening to the comment that Esther made just a few minutes ago. Why are CFOs always chosen to be CEOs? Why is this a preference over chief people officers? And I think somewhere along the line, when we look at business, we have considered that business is all about shareholder value. It's all about top line and bottom line. It's not about people. And that's the biggest problem that has happened in the last 100 years. We look at people as merely tools to achieve something else. The purpose of life is about something else. It is not about people. We don't see society centered on people, industry centered on people, enterprise centered on people. Somewhere along the line, people have just become instruments. And we think like that. So it's when we talk about objective-based management, the objective is not to make a great society. The objective is not to make a great organization. That's merely seen as a collateral benefit. The primary goal is top line, bottom line, Fortune 500 companies. The conversation is never about people. And if you see problems around the world, whether it's Brexit, whether it's Donald Trump, all these things are about people. The problem is about people. When you go to Twitter, you see the problems are about people. Now, people being the center of the world, when you're reading the Indian epics, the focus is always on people. So, it is not that top line, bottom line is not important in the Indian scriptures. Of course, they don't use words like top line and bottom line. They talk about a goddess called Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth and fortune. And she's the oldest goddess in India, in art. If you look at the art of India and study art of India, which is the first god or goddess to be carved on the walls of sacred places, and it is the goddess Lakshmi. In Buddhist stupas, Buddha said, desire is the cause of suffering. He established a monastic order. But when you go to Sanchi, Barhut, the oldest Buddhist shrines, the oldest shrines in India, you will always find the image of the goddess Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth and fortune. So clearly, India realized there's great value in wealth. So even in a monastic order, wealth was given an important place. So if wealth is given an important place, what is the relationship between wealth and people? And the idea was explained in a very simple way. They said, do you grab wealth or do you attract wealth? Do you grab wealth or do you attract wealth? And that's the question you have to ask. So do I, now look at it from an animal kingdom point of view. And a tiger, what is wealth for a tiger? A deer. It runs after a deer because deer is food. So deer is the target. What is the Hindi word for target? Laksh. From Laksh comes Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth. That's nourishment for the tiger. So the tiger runs after the deer. But now look at a flower. The flower cannot move anywhere. So it produces fragrance. It produces nectar and pollen and attracts the bees and butterflies that enables it to pollinate and transform into a fruit. So nature has both these strategies. One, that you run after wealth and it's a very violent process. The tiger, the predator running after the prey. The alternative is you attract Lakshmi by creating fragrance and color and nectar so the bees and butterfly come to you and you get what you want. You get the pollination that you want. So you attract Lakshmi and the same thing is told in the storytelling format. So you have the concept of you know, getting into the market violently. So when you read management books, they will talk in this very violent, almost vile language. We have to expand market share. We have to penetrate the market. Look at the language. It's a violent language. And we wonder why people, why suddenly there's a wave of Me Too. Because you've valorized violent masculine behavior, toxic masculinity. We have to penetrate the market. I have to be on top of everything else. These are language which is violent. It is Ranabhumi, the battleground, where you fight, and when you fight and then you grab market share, so you grab Lakshmi. So Ranabhumi, in the battleground, you create Lakshmi by grabbing her. It's a violent process. So Indra, the king of Swarga, is always involved in battle. He's always involved in battle with the Asuras. Devasura Sangram, constantly fighting. Either he has lost his market share or he's afraid of losing his market share, which means he's always under threat. But an alternate model is presented. There is Vishnu, who is in Rangabhumi, the performance ground, the stage, where he performs so beautifully that the audience is so happy that they throw money at him. And Lakshmi comes towards him joyfully. It's not a win-lose situation, it's a win-win situation, because Vishnu is trying to delight the audience. He doesn't want to penetrate the market. He wants to attract the market. Come, I have such lovely products, such lovely services. And therefore, Vishnu manifests, and he manifests in different forms depending on the requirements of the market. So one market is called Ramayan, the other market is called Mahabharat. Very different markets. One is in the Treta Yug, the other is in the Dwapar Yug. Two different contexts. In one, Vishnu descends as the eldest son of the royal family. In the other, he is the youngest son in a cowherd family. Contexts are different. The same God in two different contexts cannot behave in the same way. You have to adapt. You have to be agile. You have to transform. How do you transform? And the word used is avatar. And around the world, when I go and I tell people, what is avatar? When I go to Europe and America, they will say, oh, avatar, of course we know avatar. And they're talking about video gaming avatars. And I said, oh, it's just wearing a mask. And they think avatar is superhero. And I said, no. It is the very opposite of a superhero, but who cares for Indian knowledge? A superhero is an ordinary man who becomes extraordinary. He's an ordinary man. Peter Parker becomes Spider-Man. Bruce Wayne becomes Batman. An ordinary man who becomes extraordinary. Avatar is an extraordinary man who becomes ordinary. So Vishnu is extraordinary, he's infinite. And he, depending on the context, becomes smaller. He becomes Ram, a mortal being with a birth and death. Or he becomes Krishna, birth and death. And therefore functions very differently in two different contexts depending on the need. You're larger than it. But you know that when I go to the finance department, I have to talk like this. When I go to the human resource department, I have to talk like that. With the sales guys, I have to have a drinking buddy relationship. Because they're always under stress. With the marketing guys, I have to treat them very differently. The conversations are different. The language is different. The body, everything changes. You have to adapt. You have to do avatarana. Small, coming down to the size that makes the other comfortable. And therefore in Ramayana and Mahabharata, the learning processes are very different. You see, in the Ramayana, Ram does not know he is Vishnu. He doesn't have knowledge of his divinity. Krishna, in the Mahabharata, knows he is divine. He knows he is smarter than everybody else. And you have to deal with people like this, right? You see people who are capable of so much but don't know their capability. And at the same time, you know, people who know their capability. And you have to harness it. You can't teach these two people in the same way. One needs to be inspired. The other needs to be shown empathy. Because the inspired ki, you know, you are capable of so much more. Empathy, you are capable of so much more. But you make everybody around you insecure. So calm down. Don't show your brilliance. So how does Krishna not show his brilliance? He is called the Purana Purusha, the supreme man. But he walks in front of everybody in a highly effeminate way. He has a peacock feather, he has sandal paste, he wears silk and flowers, he has alta in his hand, nose ring. He's doing this to make people feel safe because they say, oh my God, he's so feminine. Because men feel safe around feminine men. It's called toxic masculinity. You don't threaten me, therefore I like you. Dar nahi lagta hai. I don't get scared of you. And Krishna knows this. Oh ho. Because he can be Vishwarupa, right? He can be the great thing, but he says, no, 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 no. If I do that, Ram never does Vishwarup. He doesn't know he is that. Two different contexts, two different ways of functioning. In the Ramayana, learning is so different. In the Ramayana, when you read the Balkand, Ram is being educated by his teachers who are dealing with this child prodigy, and you have Vashishtha, who is giving him theoretical knowledge in a safe ecosystem in the ashrama. So he's taught in a very safe space. And then Vishwamitra comes along and says, this learning won't do. He is in the safe ecosystem of the palace. He needs to go to the forest. In the forest, he will know what is reality. The first task given to him is to kill Taraka, a demoness. Go and kill. The second task given to him is Ahalya, a woman who has been treated badly, to bring her back into the social fold. So he is taught ruthlessness and he is taught compassion. He is taught the two ends of the CEO spectrum. You have to be ruthless. What is killing? Taking away someone's job. Worst thing to do. You have to learn the art of how do I let a person go without taking away his dignity. Most HR people I have found don't know how to do this. You are breaking a contract. You are not breaking a relationship. But we don't know. We don't know the art of separation. Or for that matter, how do you help someone who has done something wrong or treated badly, something wrong, come back to the job? How do you enable someone? How do you be compassionate as a leader? Is it a sign of weakness? In modern society, if you're kind, you're treated as being stupid. CEOs valorize being ruthless. Ruthless CEO rather than kind CEO, generous CEO. Because it's so easy to be ruthless. It is so easy to be ruthless. It requires a lot of energy to be kind and compassionate. It's so easy to be rude and insulting. It is so difficult to be generous with praise. Genuinely generous, not falsetto. And then comes the Mahabharat, where learning is very different. You have Dronacharya teaching in the palace. And something is not right, because one thing which Dronacharya doesn't teach, all the students, he has got the Kauravas and the Pandavas, both are his students. And the Kauravas end up fighting the Pandavas. They refuse to share property. What kind of a teacher is that? He doesn't recognize his failure. I taught these students who don't know how to share property. Nobody sees the failure. We talk about Guru Dronacharya, but we don't realize the story is telling us something very, very complex. The failure of a teacher. So in the Mahabharata, Dronacharya's head is cut. His head is cut. It's called Brahmahatya. It's one of the most violent stories. A teacher, Guru Hatya, is one of the greatest sins, they say in the scriptures. Yet in the Mahabharata, Guru's head is cut because you have not taught basics. And the basic is you have not shown the kings that kingship is not about holding on to property. Kingship is about giving away property. creating an ecosystem where people can be powerful, not powerless. The best definition of leadership for me is very simple. When you walk into a leader's cabin, do you feel energized or de-energized? When you walk into, I always said, "Ye powerful aadmi hai." I said, "Let me check." When I go into the room, I get scared. Which means he's taking power from me. That means he's not powerful, he's powerless. If I walk into his cabin and feel energized, inspired, motivated, he's giving me power. He is powerful, he's giving me power. 99% of politicians and industrialists I've met are not leaders. They're hungry for power. You go there and you feel completely discharged. And you want to come back and have a drink. Which is why you have cocktails every evening. That's what happens. In the Mahabharata, you learn the tragedy of human civilization. In the Mahabharata, you see the Pandavas think they are very arrogant, but when do they learn their lesson? Like in the Ramayana, Vishwamitra takes Ram into the forest. In the Ramayana, the Pandavas are kicked into the forest because they gamble away their kingdom. What is the forest? Forest is a space where nobody thinks you are important. That is the meaning of the forest. The dog, the lion is not going to look at you and say, "Oh, Pandavas, I will not eat him." Practical terms. When you have a job and you have a lovely title, everybody loves you. You want to go to the forest? Lose your job. And you are in the market. Oh, the humiliation. No salami anymore. Nobody stands up when you walk into a room. You don't matter. Talk to any IAS officer who is retired. It's horrifying. Talk to any business. I talk to doctors. As long as they're there in the hospital, they are wah wah, great people. The moment they step out of the hospital and go to a club, nobody knows them. Kaun hai ye? Bada cardiologist hai. But I don't have a heart problem. I don't care. It's very humiliating. Vana. Vana is a place where you don't matter. And that is where you learn the most. Unfortunately, how do you create such a system in learning and development? How do you do that? How do you create a system where you don't matter at all? Pandavas go to the forest and they're humiliated repeatedly. Repeatedly. Hanuman comes in the form of an old monkey and tells Bhima, "Lift my tail, yaar, I can't get up." Bhima says, "I walk straight, I will not. I'm a prince. Everything should move when I walk." You will find this in many partnership firms. They have special lifts for partners. They can't wait in line. Hum log partner hai. Hanuman says, "Lift my tail, I can't move." You just kick it aside, and he can't. And Bhima is brought to his knees. You think you're mighty, there's someone mightier than you. Arjun thinks he's the greatest archer in the world. Shiva takes the form of a Kirat, a tribal, and defeats him in a duel and says, "Tu hoga Rajkumar apne Rajmahal mein." You may be a prince in your palace, not in the forest. These are stories of humiliation. Because the basic learning is not a skill. Archery is a skill. Language is a skill. But what is not taught is basic humanity. That you, at the end of the day, leadership is about being a great human being. Skills I will teach you. I will make you a great archer. I will make you a great fighter. I will make you a great technologist. But are you a good person? Will you terminate jobs with dignity? Will you elevate me? Will you transform me? Will you help me be a better person than I was yesterday? Will you energize me? How do you teach people to do that? How do you teach empathy? These are the big challenges of the corporate world, where we have valorized ruthlessness and market penetration. I keep using that word again and again because I keep saying how language distorts the way we think. And ultimately in the Mahabharata, the biggest learning happens when the Pandavas have to serve for 1 year as servants in the palace of King Virat. So the great King Yudhishthira has to be a servant and he's slapped for telling the truth. He's slapped for telling the truth. Here's a man who's very proud. "I always tell the truth. I always tell the truth." And the king says, "Are itna sach mat bolna. Don't tell so much truth. I like to hear lies that are good than truth which is painful." That's a lesson he's been taught. It's a brutal lesson to Yudhishthira. The king, once upon a king, is slapped. Or Bhima becomes a cook. All his life he would eat the largest share of the food, and he's told, no, you will first feed everybody, then eat. That's the lesson you will learn. Arjuna, the super macho guy who every woman loves, is told for 1 year you will live like a eunuch in the women's quarters. The super masculine guy is told you shall live like a eunuch. That's the lesson. Humanity. Bahut mard ban raha hai, kuch din napunsak ban. That's the lesson. These are all learning lessons, and Krishna is doing it. Saying, you, I am a kingmaker. I have to transform you into a king. Ram is king. And he's struggling to understand what is ruthlessness and what is compassion. Krishna is a kingmaker. He says, you have to learn how to be a good human being. Draupadi, the queen, is treated, she's abused. She's abused by the king's brother-in-law, Kichaka. He treats her because she's a servant. There is a power inequality, and that is something that we understand, right, in society. The king's brother-in-law abuses the maid servant and says, Raat ko daru leke aa. Literally, that's the line in the Mahabharata. And that is what we are reading in newspapers today, right? 2000 years ago, Kichaka Vadha story talks about the king, the prince, the entitled prince, telling everybody. And Draupadi says, how can you do this? She tells the queen, madam, what are you doing? I am your servant. You are telling me to go to his room at night with wine. This is inappropriate. She goes to the king running, saying, save me. Nobody takes care of her. She's publicly humiliated. And Yudhishthira realizes, what's the use of all the power when you cannot even protect your own wife? You want to be a king? These are stories from the Ramayana and Mahabharata. In one, you are dealing with different kinds of stories. In one, you are being taken in a controlled ecosystem from the palace into the jungle. In the Mahabharata, there is no control. You learn through failure. You allow people to fail. You allow people to go to the forest. There are different ways of learning. When you read the Ramayana and Mahabharata, you realize there's no one way of learning. It's not classroom. This Guru Shishya Parampara, this romantic notion that we have been told in India, is not exist. It is not a teacher sitting and a student learning. Krishna is the teacher. He throws them in the jungle and says, learn. Learn humanity. The content is different. The methodology is different. It shifts with context. And that's what I wanted to tell you all. Ramayana and Mahabharata, how the extraordinary beings becomes ordinary. How does he live as a student, and how does he love as a teacher? How does he function in the palace, and how does he function in the forest? These are all metaphors for learning. And I hope some of these stories inspire you to find the teacher and the student within you, and you all are able to bring Lakshmi your way, because the classroom ultimately has to be Rangabhumi, where you perform and everybody is happy and Lakshmi walks your way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Devdutt. We still have a couple of minutes to go. Would you be open to taking some questions?
Sure.
Okay, if we have any, please show us your hand and we'll make sure a mic reaches you. This gentleman here to my left.
Thank you for the opportunity. Devdutt, I heard in one of your talk, you mentioned about the change management, where in Western world, change management means A replacing B, B replacing C.
Yes.
But in Indian context, A plus B plus C is a change management. Yes. If you can elaborate, because for the learning and development professional, this is very important, not to replace Western concept and introduce Indian concept. But
you see, when people talk about change, one of the things I really noticed, especially when I did a lot of workshops in many companies, that we always talk about change as replacement. So version one replaced by version two. A better software comes along and the old software is discarded. This works in a homogeneous ecosystem. But the reality of society is we are heterogeneous. The world is diverse. For some people need version one, for some people version two, for different people need different softwares. So we don't think in terms of replacing a book. It is about building a bookshelf. So the one of the biggest lessons I learned is people think of change as replacing the book with a better book. Indian way of changing is build a bookshelf, add books, and depending on context, you can categorize them differently. Upar kya rakhna hai, what to put up, down. Depending on your needs, you will keep using different. Therefore, you can have much more knowledge. So knowledge becomes not about replacing what you know. It is about expanding what you know. And that's the model. The model is slightly different. You don't have to forget what you knew before. Don't forget anything. It will become useless, useful sometime or the other. And that is a different way of thinking. It is, you keep adding to your knowledge. You keep, when you become Krishna, you don't forget what you were also Ram at one particular time. And that creates empathy. You don't forget your past. You cannot, really you cannot forget your past. But this was the big difference I noticed in when people talk about change. Change is not about replacing. It is about adding and developing the skill of figuring it out when to use A and when to use B and when to use C. That is avatar, no? Because you become infinite and you know when to be finite. Yes.
Hi, Devdutt, good evening. I was just trying to understand what you were talking about in terms of, you know, being humble through a struggle. I think nowadays, by struggle, you get more rude because you see struggle and therefore you want to retort back to struggle.
Yes.
So what's your take on that? That's point one. Point two, you know, in today's world, as you mentioned, the powerful, you know, are people who are ruthless, etc. So by trying to be powerful, you're trying to imitate those. So how do you manage that?
See, it's recognized, you know, it's somewhere along the line, there's no self-realization. I'm sorry, you should have two questions, but I couldn't remember the first one now. It's a, you know, when, as human beings, what are we seeking? We always talk about, you know, ask people, what do you want in life? And they'll say, I want money. But really, you don't want money. What you want is a very lovely Hindi word called aukat. Humko aukat chahiye. We want position, power. We want to be the alpha predator in a relationship. And this somewhere has gone into our mindset. We think of a pecking order, and I want to continuously look down on people so that I feel powerful. That has somewhere become the vocabulary of people. And I think it doesn't help. Of course, it is a great feeling, right? To walk away by insulting someone. All the soap operas, when you see, in all the soap operas, the heroine will insult someone and walk away with aplomb and will say, "Arey, wah, 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 tashan hai usme." Compassion is not glamorous. Compassion is not glamorous at all. To see that the person is rude because he's insecure. Today I was talking to an HR head of a very large company, and I was saying that, you know, I use the word insecurity. And he said, yes, that is the foundation of all my problems. Every problem that you deal with in HR is based on some form of the insecurity that people are dealing. Will I have a job tomorrow? Why is he being paid more than me? Why is the boss preferring him to me? Why is the company changing org structure? Will I still have the corner cabin? It's all insecurity. And because I'm insecure, if you look at an insecure dog, it barks a lot. So when you see people barking, remember the insecure dog. And I think that we don't pay so much attention to the psychology of corporations. And we're focused too much on behavior to focus on insecurity. So for me, that insecurity is what I have to handle, and a good leader recognizes the insecurity because he can manipulate it. Many leaders use the insecurity and manipulate it. But I think nobility lies, and that's, of course, when you use words like nobility, we'll say, kya hai, isse paise thodi na banta hai. But it makes you a nicer and happier person. It makes you a slightly happier person. And I think if people are talking about happiness index and all that kind of things, you have to focus on insecurity, your own insecurity. Arrogance and rudeness is very nice, but I have yet to meet an arrogant person who is happy.
Yeah. Okay, we'll take the next question from you and the last question from yourself.
So, Devdutt, I really liked the concept you brought about the forest, and I really mesmerized by this thought. And I was, as you rightly mentioned, that it is really difficult to create a forest in the corporate world. But if you have any thought that how that can be created, how that barrier can be removed from the, you know, scope of the learning.
So, you know, it's a problem because it's a controlled ecosystem. My job is not to go away. I'm safe. The thing is, today you don't have to create. Every job is a forest because you're in a VUCA system. No, there is no guarantee that tomorrow the job will stay. Nobody can give you guarantee of a job today because the world is changing so dramatically. A new software, a new product, a new service will come and everything will go redundant. And we are really living in that ecosystem where everything has become so fragile. So effectively, that is the least of your problem today. Ye vanavas mein hai sab log hai. Sab log vanavas mein. So that is not a problem. How do you thrive in a VUCA ecosystem? Is the question, is the challenge that you have. Is it skills that will take you through the forest? Is it attitude? But it's not about attitudes. I feel skills are important, but really empathy is the key word. The ability to understand that you live in an ecosystem of fear. I think that for me, in my learning, that is the biggest learning I've figured out. That when I walk into a negotiation room, I'm fully aware of the insecurities in the room. And then I know how to talk. And that requires practice, because it is a skill to sense the fear in the room. Some people do it intuitively. That is lucky people. But most of us have to learn. In our relationship with our parents, our spouses, and our children, we do not see the insecurity that is destroying it. Right now, I am going through a relationship crisis. And it's a very funny thing, because logically, everything is okay. But I am insecure. So I'm phoning 10 times a day. Sab theek hai na? Sab theek hai na? Sab theek hai na? And somebody's like, your neediness is oppressive. And I can't control it. So to be aware of it, even with all the knowledge in the world and writing 40 books, kuch farak nahi padta hai. Because everybody's like, Guruji nahi hote hai. Gurujis are as insecure as anybody else. So I've met many of them. You just have to know what question to ask. And then tharthritis starts. Yeah. So that's
all right, we're running really short on time. We'll take our next question from the lady. Answer you. Let's keep it brief, please.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, so empathy, compassion that you talk about is so relatable. And I don't think in this room anybody has a debate in mind about that. But how do you get really as a custodian of culture, of learning, of creating learning organizations to get your CXOs to really appreciate it? What are one or two methodologies that you could probably, recommend from all the learnings of Ramayana Mahabharata?
See, in a family-owned organization, I just go to the CEO. When I talk to the CEO, I say, sir, aapka paisa hai. Nahin karna toh mat karo na, kuch farak nahin padta hai. It is not my responsibility, it's your responsibility. Paisa tumhara hai. And I'm being brutal about it. Because I work in companies with horrible culture and they want to outsource it to me. They hire me as culture consultant. And I'm like, you can't outsource culture. Absolutely. Vishnu Vaikunth ka janam karta hai. You can't tell, acha, Vaikunth expert, come and build Vaikunth for me. Vishnu banoge to Vaikunth banta hai. I'm sorry, those who are not from India may not get this understanding. It means the deity creates heaven. You can't create heaven if you're the devil. If you're the devil, you'll create hell. If you're God, you'll create heaven. You have to transform to create a cultural shift. So you don't carry the burden. Learning and Development Department does not have to carry the burden of culture. They will say, tumhara culture nahi chal raha hai. Sir, aapka culture hai. Bhaiya, paisa tumhara. And I'm brutal about it. I said, paisa mein, I have come to you for money. This is a skill I have, but unfortunately, the rate limiting factor of my skill is your intelligence. So, karo kya?
Okay, got that for family-owned organizations. What about the corporate executives? Because unka to paisa bhi nahi ja raha hai.
So then you know where you stand, right? See, you know where you stand. When somebody tells me value-based organization, I have only one Hindi word which begins with C.
Awesome.
Because what jhoot bol raha hai? I know it is a lie. See, I have worked very hard to come to a position where I can tell the truth. I know many people can't tell the truth. I have come, luckily, by God's grace, by work, hard work, everything, I can stand on a stage and say the truth. And I've worked with people, I said, jhoot bol raha hai tu. We are a value-based company. I'm like, right. You know what I mean? It doesn't work like that. These are nice words and framing and jargon and jumla. Doesn't work. Reality is reality. You want this culture, I will create. Most of them want domesticated animals. And if they want domesticated animals, you should just give them domesticated animals and get your bonus. Don't take the burden. Learning and development does not. The burden of culture rests with the board of directors, not even with the CEO. Only the board of directors. If the company is shit, it is the board of directors that are the problem, not the CEO, because they make the life of the CEO miserable. We are very wrong to say the buck stops with the CEO. It doesn't. It stops with the board of directors, who can be very, very nasty. When they all want values until the profit is not met. Then values chhod do, profit leke aao. First profit, then values. Never first values, then profit. So I'm very clear of how board of directors function, and let's not pretend they're noble creatures from heaven. No, they're not.
All right, last question, sir. Very quick and very brief, please.
Devdutt, you spoke about the fact why CHROs don't become as many CEOs. In the future, what do you see CHROs and other HR professionals doing to crack this code of?
I think you have to take up assignments which involves dealing with balance sheets. You have to take up a 1 year sabbatical low, 2 year sabbatical low. If you have not handled the balance sheet, it is very difficult for becoming a CEO. Balance sheet management is the key. I was very lucky, very early stage. I became an executive assistant to a CEO. And I think that was the best thing I did, but only for 1 year, because then you get access. And then I did consulting, and I realized if you have not handled the balance sheet, nobody respects you. I think that is one, somewhere in your careers, please make sure for at least 1 year you handle, and even if you fail, it is okay. Even if you fail, it is okay. Failure, and in fact, I remember one of the big businessmen saying his first question in interviews would be, tell me about your failure. Because failure is when you learn, na jungle, when you didn't matter at all. Failure is when you learn. So allow yourself to fail. Please turn learning and development into a profit center. Figure out a way. Or think like that. I don't know what the answers are, but I think otherwise learning and development centers become cost centers. And the moment you become cost centers, nobody loves you in the corporate world. You have to figure out a way of becoming a profit center. It is a notional profit center. And you have to get the buy-in of the CEO. But I think balance sheet management, unfortunately, is the key. Abhi kaise karoge, kya karoge, I don't know. But balance sheet is a must. Rokda. And that is my biggest learning I learned, that if you don't understand balance sheet, growth in corporate world, it's very nice to say things, but they will not give it to you. There'll be a glass ceiling and they will shut you out. You have to deal with the balance sheet. Yeah?
All right, then unfortunately that's all the time we have, ladies and gentlemen. Devdutt Pattanaik once again. Thank you very much, Devdutt.